Two or three things before we start. We've already started, right? Okay, two or three things anyway. On Thursday nights, I teach a class at something called the Columbia School of Biblical Study. Impressive? No. Down at the Graymere Church of Christ. And one of the students who is very faithful in his attendance, has been for years, is Wayne England. Wayne is an elder at the Antioch Church of Christ. Now, there are a bunch of Antioch Churches of Christ. This is the one down in the southern end of Murray County, almost to the Marshall County line. In fact, if you go there, and I've held meetings there, spoken on Vacation Bible School, and I don't know what all, but you go through a little part of Marshall County and go back into Murray County. I hadn't figured that one out yet. But anyway, it's a good small country church. Wayne asked me the other night to make an announcement. And I didn't have anything to write on but this napkin. So anyway, on November the 6th, that's next Saturday, Brad Harrop will be speaking at the Antioch Church of Christ from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. And I think Wayne said the subject was home leadership, or I think he was summarizing leadership in the home. He wanted me to announce that, especially because Brad's doing it. And if you want to go down, I've been down. They have a good crowd. Pre-COVID crowds were very good. I don't know since COVID started. And it's a men's retreat. Sorry, ladies. It's a men's retreat. And not only can you spend the day with them, they will feed you lunch. They have a very nice kitchen and dining area, and I mean, they'll feed you a good lunch, I know from experience. So anyway, I promised Wayne I would do that, and I'll not be going, not because of the speaker, but that's the buddy walk. Buddy walk ain't gonna be no buddy walk because of COVID. We always go out to the Hermitage, and we spend the day cooking out and socializing and sitting around talking. And then they finally do get around to walking. And we walk around part of the Hermitage area and all of that stuff. But for the second year in a row, we're going up to, I believe it's called the Highland Rim Speedway. And we're going to drive around that. Decorate our cars and drive around the speedway. That's next Saturday, the buddy walk. And by the way, and I'm kind of kidding around about that a little bit, but let me say in all seriousness, to all of you who may have given a donation to the buddy walk, Linda has been the one doing the raising of the money, not me, but she raised over $2,000, and almost all of that came from members of this church. And thank you. Thank you very, very much. Okay, let's get down to the business at hand. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day and for all your blessings, and thank you for this time that you've provided for us to spend together and think about these things that are eternal. Be with us and bless us that we will grow stronger in the faith and be better servants in your kingdom because of the time we spend together. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, since we do have a short class, I'm not as encouraged as I thought I would be that we will get through chapter 22 today. We are ready for chapter 22, verse 39. We will cover at least as much of this. I would like for us to cover it all today. But we have two more chapters to cover in Luke, 23 and 24. We have four Sundays left in this quarter, four Sundays in November. And the last two chapters, like most of the chapters in Luke, are very long. But if we can take those two chapters, divide each of them in half, we can probably cover those two chapters in four classes and get ourselves through. That's what we're going to try to do, because the first Sunday in December, we start a new series of studies, an altogether new series of studies. That's when the new quarter begins. So, having said that, let's get to it. Verse 39, coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives. Now, here again, get the picture in your mind. They leave the walled city of Jerusalem through that particular gate that leads them down into the Kidron Valley. In the bottom of the Kidron Valley, there is a brook. That brook, very appropriately, is the brook Kidron. They start up the other side, and they are now ascending the Mount of Olives. Off to the left, at the base of the Mount of Olives, there is a garden. It is a garden filled with olive trees. At one time, during probably the time of Jesus, in fact, there was an olive press there. They harvested the olives from the trees. They pressed the oil out of the olives and collected that, and it became a mainstay for their cooking. You've probably noticed that it's, I guess, somewhat of a fad. I'm not sure that's the right word. But how many things, these people doing recipes on television and advertising products, how many cooking things are done with olive oil? Because it is healthy. Linda buys mayonnaise that is made with olive oil because she's trying to make me a little bit more healthy, and I need to be a little bit more, a lot more healthy than I am. But that's the situation. Now, they have been across the Mount of Olives because Bethany is on the other side. They've been across the Mount of Olives many, many times. Several times, the Bible indicates, they have spent all night on the Mount of Olives. During Passover week, there are so many people in town that any kind of lodging within the walls of the cities had been taken up a long time before. People were sleeping wherever they could find a place to sleep, and it seems that one of the main places was to go out of the walled city, go to the Mount of Olives, and basically camp out. They slept overnight out in the open on the Mount of Olives. Okay, so Jesus is going to the Mount of Olives. He's going to Gethsemane. Now notice, as he was accustomed, he had done this many times, his disciples followed him, and he came to the place. The place refers to the Garden of Gethsemane. And he says to those disciples who were with him, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he was withdrawn from them, notice, about a stone's throw. And he knelt down and prayed. Now, I have always thought that the prayer in John 17 was prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. But most of the commentaries, the more recent, more thorough ones that I've been looking at, tell, or at least seem to indicate, that the prayer of John 17 may have been prayed before they left the upper room, and that they went out into the garden, and here Jesus prays a different prayer then, in which he says, "Father, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me." Either way, so you've got Jesus praying, you've got the farewell discourse of John 13, 14, and 15, and 16. You've got the Passover. You've got the Lord's Supper. You've got the exposure of Judas as the betrayer. You've got the prophecy that Peter's going to deny him. All of that now is past tense. And notice verse 46. We're not that far yet, are we? Okay. Pray that you enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn a stone's throw. He knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, let this cup pass away from me, or take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him, and that angel was from heaven, and it strengthened him. The word here is almost like somebody working out. Jesus isn't working out. I don't mean to say that. But it's the idea that if you do your workouts often enough and intensely enough, it's going to make you stronger. Jesus is made stronger by his prayer to God. He's made stronger by this angel who comes to strengthen him. But notice verse 44, he's in agony. I understand, though there are other forms of this word that appear. Contend earnestly for the faith would be another form of this same word. But this particular word, I understand, translated agony in verse 44, doesn't appear anywhere else in the New Testament. Because something really intense is going on here. Jesus knows what the future for him is going to be. He knows how serious it all is, and he says, if it's your will, take this cup away. But he's being strengthened by his prayer. He's being strengthened by the angel, but still there's agony. And so he prays more earnestly or more fervently. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. That is a very controversial statement. It kind of gets us back where we were last week, and we don't need to go there again. What day was Jesus crucified on? What do you mean right here? Did he literally pray so hard that his blood popped out, his capillaries burst? Or is this a figure of speech? His sweat became like. Remember English class similes and metaphors? His sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. Either way, he's got a mixture of grief and anxiety. He's exhausted. He's been up a long time. Really hasn't had a lot to eat. So he is very tired and very strained and very worn altogether anyway. But he prays his prayer. The sweat becomes like great drops of blood. He rises up from the prayer, comes to the disciples, and finds them sleeping from sorrow. They are so grief-stricken that they have become exhausted. The New English Bible says they were worn out by grief, and that's why they've fallen asleep. Then he said to them, why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation. He's already said much the same thing back in verse 40. Pray that you may not enter into temptation. And while he was speaking, behold, I've told you many times, the word behold always means sit up and pay attention. Something important's really about to happen. There's a multitude. Now, here again, controversy. How many people does it take to constitute a multitude? I don't know. There are some who speculate, and I don't think this is right, that a detachment of troops was sent, combining Roman soldiers, Jerusalem Jewish temple police, and that all of the group together could have been as many as 600 people. I don't see that. But nonetheless, there's a multitude, and he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them, stepped out. It's like here's the group with Jesus, here's the group with Judas. Judas steps out across the group and goes directly to Jesus. There's been a prearranged signal. The one I kiss, that's the one you're looking for. Okay. He who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? In the parallels in both Matthew and Mark make it very clear that Judas actually did kiss Jesus. And the force of the language is that not like that, but that he literally kissed Jesus repeatedly. Because he wants to make sure they get the right man. After all, among other things, he's got 30 pieces of silver involved, right? He's made a deal. He's got to betray the right person or he's not going to get his money, most likely. So he does kiss him. He kisses him repeatedly. When those around him saw what was going to happen, they said to him, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? Both Matthew and Mark tell us that when the mob came out, they brought with them swords and clubs and lanterns. The lanterns were because it's sometime between midnight and sunup. So they've got to have their way lit up or lighted, as the word may be. Matthew and Mark mention swords and clubs. One of them struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. Now, we don't know exactly when Luke was written, but it was probably written prior to AD 70. I suspect even prior to AD 64. Luke doesn't mention the name of the one who struck the servant of the high priest, nor does he mention the name of the servant himself. The one who struck the servant of the high priest with a sword, who was that? That's Peter. Everybody got that one. Struck the high servant of the high priest, cut off not his left ear. Isn't that specific? Not his left ear, but his right ear. What was the name of that fella? Malchus. Okay, yeah, see. Now, John tells us this in John chapter 18. But anyway, But 51, Jesus answered and said, permit even this. All right, but the point seems to be just this and no more. That's enough. We're not going any further. He touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priest, now watch this. You've got the chief priests. Which group are they of? They're Jews, right? Okay. You've got the captains of the temple. They're probably Jews as well. This is like the chief of police of the temple group. They are the temple police. During Passover, the crowds are going to be shoulder to shoulder in the temple and around the temple. Somebody has got to be in control. So they've got these temple police, and they're not just for Passover. They're there all the time. But they're probably reinforced with more right now, and they're trying to keep down any riot or rebellion or any kind of thing like this. Jesus then says, have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs? When I was with you daily in the temple. Now remember, we have been talking about in part the last week of the earthly life of our Lord, when every day he seems to have either gone out to stay on the Mount of Olives or over to Bethany to stay with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. But every morning he has gotten up. He has come across the mountain if that was necessary. He has gone into the holy city. And he seems to have, once he got inside the gates, gone directly to the temple and spends all day, or at least the biggest part of it, teaching. When I was with you daily in the temple, you did not try to seize me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness. So they arrested him. They led him and they brought him to the high priest's house. Now, we get what I'm about to tell you from John. John, I don't think, I might not have said this a while ago. Luke writes pre-AD 64, most likely. John doesn't write until 80 or 85. There's a, 50-year gap of time in there. By then, most of the principals in the story are dead. So John is a little bit more specific, to say the least, than Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And John mentions not only Peter as being the one who cuts off the ear, Malchus as the one who gets his ear cut off. But now, there are some things John tells us that we would not know if we didn't have John. Okay, so here's one of them. They brought him into the high priest's house. If you follow the order of events that takes place in order, John makes it very clear that the first place to which they go is to the household of Annas, A-N-N-A-S. Annas is the father-in-law of Caiaphas, or some people prefer to call him Caiaphas. Caiaphas, or Caiaphas, is the actual reigning high priest. But Annas is still looked on by both the Jews and certainly by the Romans as the real power behind the throne. You see how political all of this is? It's not much about religion or Christianity or even Jewry, if that's what you would call the Jewish faith. It's political. And so these people go, first of all, to Annas. What they're going to do in the household of Annas is have a hearing. And in this hearing, they're going to try to come up with a charge. They've got to get a charge that will stick with both the Jews and the Romans. Yeah, okay. So they're at Annas' house. He's the father-in-law of the actual reigning high priest. Now, at one time, Annas was the high priest. But Annas got himself deposed. He was deposed by Rome because he didn't like his job, didn't like the work he did. But somehow he manages to get, at some point, most of this comes from Josephus, by the way. Annas had sons. I don't remember how many, don't know that we even say. Annas' sons each took a turn at being high priest. But none of them satisfied Rome. So when Annas had been deposed, the sons had been deposed, they still managed to get it kept within the family because Caiaphas is not a son. He's a son-in-law, exactly. So you see, Annas, the sons, Caiaphas, etc. It's kind of a mixed political bag is what you've got. But anyway, so they arrested Jesus. They brought him into the high priest's house. First of all, Annas, later on Caiaphas. We will probably have to do most of this next time. It's already about 8 or 9 minutes till 11. There is a book written by a man named William Chandler. If you were to even go looking for the book, you probably couldn't find it. It was written early in the 20th century. Chandler was a member of the State Supreme Court of New York. He wrote a book, I have a copy of it in paperback, called The Trial of Jesus. It is probably the most interesting thing I've ever read on what Jesus had to endure with what were nothing but mock trials that were as crooked as they could possibly be. I think John MacArthur, in his book, The Murder of Jesus, isn't that a title? The Murder of Jesus does a pretty good job, but I don't think anybody can touch Chandler. So he was a lawyer, he was a state Supreme Court judge, and he put some time in to come up with this book that really goes into detail. Okay, now 54, latter part of 54. Peter followed at a distance. Now I'm just going to do a lot of reading here because I think we can do that and maybe get through with this. Now when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them because it was cold. And he probably didn't think anybody was going to recognize him. And a certain servant girl, seeing him as he sat by the fire, looked intently at him and said, "This man was also with him." All right. So somebody does recognize him after all. But he denied him, the him being Jesus, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." And after a little while, another saw him and said, "You also are of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then after about an hour had passed, another, third time now, confidently affirmed, saying, "Surely this fellow also was with him, for he is a Galilean." All right. Three different people have identified him, but Peter says again, "Man, I do not know what you are saying." Now, Jesus has already told Peter that before all of this is over, the cock or the rooster is going to crow for three times. Immediately while he was speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." So Peter went out and wept bitterly. Yeah. Now the men who had held Jesus, and we need to say a lot more about this, but we don't have time to do it. Maybe we can get it in next time. The men who had held Jesus mocked him and they beat him. They blindfolded him. They struck him on the face. They mockingly said, "Prophesy, who is the one that struck you?" And many other things they did. They blasphemously spoke against him. All right. And as soon as it was day, the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes. And again, chief priests would be Sadducees. Scribes would more likely be Pharisees and not necessarily even Pharisees. Came together and led him into their council. Now, John will give us a lot more detail than Luke does. The point is, they now think they have a charge. So they're going to take Jesus before the council. What's another name for the council? The Sanhedrin, exactly. They're sitting in that horseshoe formation, and the chief priest is sitting right there in the middle of it, and Jesus is down here at the open end of the horseshoe, and he's the one being accused. Okay. "If you are the Christ, if you are the Messiah, tell us." But he said to them, "If I tell you, you will by no means believe." You're not going to believe me if I tell you, so why should I bother? "And if I also ask you, you will by no means answer me or let me go." Now a prophecy comes in. "Hereafter, the Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God." We've talked about that so much, we won't pursue that right now because of lack of time. But prophetic statement, "The Son of Man will sit on the right hand of the power of God." Then they all said, "Are you then the Son of God?" So he said to them, "You rightly say that I am." And yes, you're right. You finally got one thing right. all the things wrong, you finally got something right. And they said, what further testimony do we need? For we have heard it ourselves from his own mouth. They think they have a bona fide charge that will stick. First of all, it's got to stick with the Jewish council. The charge before the Jewish council amounts to blasphemy because he's claimed to be the Son of God. When they get to Pilate, at the hearings, plural, before Pilate, the charge will not be blasphemy. Because Pilate couldn't have cared less about a charge of blasphemy. So he claims to be the Son of God. So what? Big deal. Get out of here. So they come up with another charge. What is it? Treason. Exactly. He is a threat to Caesar. If he sets up this kingdom he's talking about, then he becomes a threat to Caesar and to Rome. And Caesar and Rome don't stand for things like that. So, okay, he's got to die. Okay, that's a little bit ahead because Pilate's going to try. Give old Pilate, as bad as he is in so many ways, give him a badge of merit for at least trying to solve this without executing Jesus. Can't do it. Okay, so we got through it. Hey, by flying. I sat down yesterday and figured this out. 56 for chapter 23, 53 for chapter 24, 56. Is that 109? 110, round it off because I don't do math very well. 2 into 110, 5. No. Yeah? 4. Anyway, we got a lot of work to do. May have to have some extra class meetings. No? Nobody said, hey, yeah, that sounded like a good idea. All right, let's have our prayer and you can go a little early. Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you for the time we've spent together. Thank you most of all for your Son, through whom we pray. Amen. Okay.